Did you know that nanoparticles, the very tiny particles in polluted air, might enter the human brain, which could be an environmental fact that contribute to Alzheimer's disease? But how nanoparticles enter the brain remains unknown and is a topic on intense research. I'm Dr. Zhiling Guo. I'm a research fellow at the University of Birmingham. I have worked as a molecular research fellow in the environmental nanoscience group over the past 2 years. My mercury project studied the transport of engineered nanomaterials across the blood-brain barrier to understand both the benefits for medicine and the potential risks. With results just published in the journal Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, the blood-brain barrier, known as the BBB, is a physical barrier composed of a tightly packed single-cell layer that lines all blood vessels, and it separates the blood from the brain. Thanks to the BBB, the human brain is a well-protected organ. The BBB keeps potentially dangerous toxins and passengers outside the brain while allowing oxygen and essential nutrients in. The BBB is extremely good at what it does. However, it isn't perfect. So here at the University of Birmingham, we made a recent discovery. We found that nanoparticles have the potential to pass from the bloodstream to brain using a cellular model, and we are exploring how nanoparticles do this. Nanoparticles can be naturally generated. Think volcanoes or diesel exhaust from cars, or manufactured for different application purposes. There are already thousands of different types of engineered nanomaterials on the market. For example, zinc oxide nanomaterials, which have been widely used in sunscreen cream and nappy cream. And these nanomaterials are made with different characteristics, such as different composition, shape, size, surface charge, and coatings. These characteristics can make their biological effects and behavior distinct from each other. And these characteristics are the key to understanding their potential transport across BBB. We created a library of metallic nanomaterials with different particle compositions, sizes, and shapes, including ones similar to those widely applied in commercial products such as silver, iron oxide, zinc oxide, and cerium oxide nanoparticles. To analyze their transport across BBB, we used a well-established in vitro cell-based model and a set of new analytical techniques. With this, we were able to quantify and image the transport and transformation of the nanoparticles inside the BBB and determine the small portion that were able to reach the brain side of the cellular barrier. We found that the physicochemical properties of metallic nanomaterials influence how effective they are at penetrating the in vitro model of the blood-brain barrier and their potential levels of toxicity in the brain. Higher concentrations of spherical and disc-like silver nanomaterials and zinc oxide nanomaterials, which have high dissolution, may damage cells and cause increased permeability of the BBB, therefore allowing even more nanomaterials to cross the BBB by squeezing in between the cells in the process called paracellular transport. Also, nanomaterials can transport through well-regulated transport routes used to nourish the brain, called the transcytosis-mediated routes, although this portion was relatively low. The data presented in our study not only provide important new insights into nanomaterials' interaction with and transport through and from the BBB, but also will help to design safer nanomaterials and could open up new ways of targeting hard-to-reach locations when treating brain diseases, such as Alzheimer's and brain cancer. Although you may not know it, nanoparticles are part of our daily lives, being present in cosmetics and healthcare products. It is important to understand that our work was performed in the model system, and as such, doesn't yet prove that they can cross the human BBB. Indeed, the human body has multiple other barriers that particles have to cross in order to even reach the bloodstream, the air-lung barrier, for example. But in vitro model, they do stress that there is this potential, and that to ensure human safety, we need to continue researching these important questions. Thank you for listening and watching. If you want to know more, the paper is available in the link below.